So along with his body, there are some belongings. There is a NBA championship watch. There's an NBA championship ring. And there's also a wallet, money, and some other personal belongings. So what happened with all these things?
Okay, well, see, that's one of the things that's definitely been twisted around. When we put his body in the water, now, whether he, you know, at some point, you know, like went through his pockets, got a wallet out or something like that, I don't know. Because, like I said, I've never seen one. I never saw a wallet. I never saw any ID. I never saw any money that came from him that I knew of. Larry had money already, of course, but I don't know, like, for a fact that the money came from him. About 3 days later, we were in Fayetteville, North Carolina, with the car. I think it was on a Monday, which would have been the 26th. And this was just before we actually ended up getting rid of the car. I was looking for a change to make a phone call because my brother, his phone was in his ex, you know, name, so you couldn't make, like, a long-distance call. He's living, like, in a trailer park. Like, at the time, he's in the military. He's a sergeant in the Army. So he's living in a trailer park outside of Fayetteville. So I get in the car, and I ride around, and I find, like there's a bank of phones. So I say, okay, I'm going to make a, you know, I'm just going to go ahead and call. So I try to call Collector first. Whoever I was trying to call, I think maybe my sister, somebody, she didn't accept the call. So I, like, go back in the car, and I'm looking for change. And as I'm looking for change, like, in the middle of the console, there's like a door. I don't know if you've ever been like in a Lexus or one of modern cars. Because you got to think, well, I didn't even realize that this Lexus was like an expensive car. I thought it was like a Toyota, just like a name of a Toyota, because I hadn't been locked up for 2.5 years. I'd never even seen one. But, and, you know, when I went and kind of pressed down, it kind of flipped around, and inside of it, it was a watch, and there was an all-star ring. I'd never seen a championship ring, period. I never had one on. There was a stipulation that they said that Michael Jordan identified a ring on my finger. That was a lie. They lied on a Michael Jordan, come to find out. He never said that. But there was an all-star ring, which was made out of like a silver type of material. That didn't look expensive, to be honest with you. And there was a watch, and there was a picture of a child, like, in the same thing. So that was found 3 days later. And that's why, if you look at the trial transcript, the like, girls that was with us, like, the same day that this murder happened, and the day after, people that, like, nobody saw me with this ring or with this watch until that Monday. That's when I found it. And when I found it, you know, to be honest with you, it's like, it says Michael Jordan, like, has Jordan on it, right? It has the Bulls. It's something that has Jordan's name on it. So I'm like, wow, this is cool. And I'm like, Larry, what's up with this? He said, man, I don't know. He said, man, you know, look, I like fake to me. I said, yeah, you know, I'm thinking it's like maybe like commemorative stuff or whatever that you can order. Didn't nobody think it was real, man. But I put it on because, you know, it had Jordan brand on it.
Okay. And you actually ended up going back to your house at some point and making a rap video while wearing this ring and watch.
Right. That was made in Fayetteville. Yeah, that was made while we were in Fayetteville. So this was okay. This was made like immediately, maybe an hour or two after I found this watch in the ring.
Okay. So you guys dump the body and you guys drive around in this Lexus for like 3 days, right?
Well, that Friday, Saturday, so us and a lot of people, like, basically everybody was joyriding. There was a lot of people that was involved, a lot of people that were never charged, even questioned, but there was a lot of people joyriding, you know, because you got to think, bro, I know that somebody has gotten killed. I know that this person has gotten killed. I'm thinking that I know, because of course I didn't. I didn't know what I was being told and making my own conclusions. But, you know, what I'm being told and what I'm thinking is that, okay, that this car did not belong to this person that just got killed. And this person that got killed, that he's a mule, that's sending his drugs, like, he's basically dropping it off. So it's not his car. 9 times out of 10, it's either, you know, it's either a car that's hot, but it's clean, like, it's stolen, but it's clean enough for you to move in to make this trip, or it's a rental car. That's what I'm thinking. So that's why I had no problem, you know, making phone calls from the car. We was riding around, like I said, a lot of us, man, you know, and showing off, because I'm 18 years old, I just got out of prison. So you're in a nice car, and you pull up, and people are like, wow, that's a nice car. So it's, you know, just kind of like, you know, I'm not going to say that it's normal, but it is normal, unfortunately, where you have people that ride around in vehicles that's not theirs, and they rent vehicles from crackheads or that's involved in something. So, you know, yeah, we had it for like Friday, Saturday, Sunday, and I think Monday, and I could be mistaken about Monday, it could have been Tuesday, was the day that we went out and talked to some guys, and we ended up leaving the car out there, which was supposed to come back and pick it up. Larry was supposed to come back and pick it up, and that's when they pretty much stole the car from us, because they moved the car out of the woods or something.
Eventually, they found the car in the woods in Fayetteville, North Carolina, about 60 miles from where the body was initially found. And the car was completely stripped down. So how did that car get stripped down?
Well, after we left the car, and I can't say for certain because I wasn't there and didn't even know these guys, but like I didn't know these guys at all. You know, we didn't initially go out there to sell this car or anything of that nature, which is what people testified to and what Larry said. That's not why we went out there. We initially went out there because he had some of the coke on him. He was trying to trade the coke off or something. But once we got out there, and then everybody started talking about Michael Jordan, and somebody said something about the place. They said, man, you know, that's Michael Jordan's number, 23, and he went to UNC Chapel Hill. Now, this may sound crazy to a lot of people because I'm black, and I guess, you know, they expect black people to know this. I didn't grow up watching basketball at all. Like, I never knew until that summer that Michael Jordan played for UNC Chapel Hill. I had no connection to UNC Chapel Hill. You know, I think I hadn't been in North Carolina for years. I hadn't stayed in North Carolina since I was a little kid. So, you know, the only thing I know about Michael Jordan is that summer, really, before I got out, there was a finals. They were playing the Knicks when I got home that day. They was playing the Knicks. So, you know, I know Michael Jordan is from the sneakers. The very first pair of shoes I had in Jordans, I worked for them, got them. You know, and somebody robbed me of my shoes, and like some grown guys stuck me up and got them. But that's, like, I don't really know what, you know, so when people, they're like, saying this, and then I start putting things together, like, real quick. Like, damn, that's why you have a Chicago Bull air freshener in this car. That's why, like, on the golf bags, because there was some golf bags in there as well, with a name on a piece of tape, and over it, and it was over Michael Jordan's name. But I'm thinking it's just a Michael Jordan brand golf bag. Like, you just, but like, there's no way possible. Anybody can say what they want to say. Nobody in that position going to know this is Michael Jordan stuff. So when the guy said that, we left the car because my brother didn't want the car back at his house. You know, I think he had a wrong, you know, he had a bad feeling about it. So we just left the car. We were supposed to come back and pick it up, you know. And when we got back in contact with them, they was like, man, such and such, he's not here. They're not here. Okay, we'll call back. So I said, man, them dudes probably have already done something with this car. Well, by that time, I'm figuring out more because one of my brothers showed me a video of Michael Jordan. And I want to say it was called Come Fly With Me, but I can't remember if that's the exact one. But he was driving a car just like that Lexus. I don't think it was the same color, but I think it was the same kind. And it could have been the same car. I don't know. But when I saw that, and my other brother, he was like, man, that car, like, you know, Michael Jordan, bro, he's like, you know, something happened, somebody got killed with the mob and the gambling, and well, I bet you that that's, you know what I'm saying, he probably, you know, just a lot of stuff that scared the hell out of me. And I'm like, man, hey, man, I'm not trying to get back in touch with them guys. If they got the car, let them keep the car. If they get out of the car, that's on them. You know what I'm saying? Because I didn't want to have nothing to do with the situation once it started dawning on me what was really going on. So I can't say, but this car was stripped down. I can't say who stripped the car down, but the guys, two or three of the guys, pled guilty to possession of stolen goods and I guess whatever the charges were that related to them, you know, stripping the car. But I can't say for like myself, I never saw the car no more once we got outside the car